Hello friends, I am Dr. Ajay Yadav, and today we are going to discuss INI CET recall 2020 questions of anesthesia. And fortunately, the questions of anesthesia were simple and straightforward. If you have even done the basics of the anesthesia, you would have been able to solve the questions. So, without wasting any time, let's start with the question number one. Excuse me. Ideal CPR is chest compression 100 to 120, respiratory breaths 20 to 24, depth of 5 cm during chest compressions. Okay. So, chest compressions 100 to 120, same, that is right. Now, respiratory rate for children has been changed. Respiratory rate for children previously, you know, used to be 10 breaths per minute, same like adults. However, as per 2020 guidelines, respiratory rate for children and infants had been changed from 20 to 30, but for adults it is still remains same, that is 10 breaths per minute. So in this they have not mentioned about pediatric CPR, so we are considering that they are asking adult CPR. So in adult CPR, respiratory rate is still 10 breaths per minute, means one breath every 6 seconds. For children, if they would have asked, then this choice would have been right, because I told you now for children, pediatric age group, respiratory rate has become 20 to 30 breaths per minute, means one breath after every 2 to 3 seconds. And compression depth, yes, 2 inches. 2 inches equivalent to 5 centimeter. And so, and A and C are correct. A and C correct. Choices are A, B, yes, B. So B. Okay. But if it would have been given pediatric CPR, then all, then chest compression would have been changed. Yes, chest compression for children is 1.5 inch, not 2 inches. And this was very much expected. So, regarding breath rate, they would have definitely asked. And many people I know by mistake would have marked respiratory rate 20 to 24, considering it as pediatric. So, sometimes that is a problem of these type of exams. Question are simple but tricky, because you would have a mindset, now respiratory rate has changed. So, I am sure that many of you would have marked ABC. But respiratory rate has changed only for pediatric age group. Okay. Next question. What is the use of this cart? Central line insertion, arterial line insertion, airway cart, crash cart. Again, very simple. Anyone, even who would have not studied anesthesia or anything, would have answered. It contains laryngoscope. It contains all laryngoscope blades. All sizes are there. Even straight blade with curved tip, that is Miller is available, Macintosh is available, two blade sizes, nasal airway, so this is nasal airway, this is oral airway, that is Goodell's airway, syringe to fill the endotracheal tube, then McCoy laryngoscope blade is there, then Magill forceps, so this all set is obviously airway card. So very simple, just a matter of common sense. Crash cart, in crash cart, in addition to these airway equipments, there will be endotracheal tubes. They are separately kept in a box. Then there will be all medicines, drugs, IV set, everything is there. So in crash cart, is a trolley at least having 4 or 5 different rows. So this is airway management set. Question number 3. You find a patient lying unconscious while jogging in the morning. What would you do? See, now all questions are coming through CPR or airway management. So that really nowadays, they are only focusing more on clinical part rather than non-clinical part of any subject actually. The questions are really clinical. Check carotid pulse, CPR, call for help. Okay, we'll read the choices later. First, let's, without looking at the choices, let's see the management of an unconscious patient. If you encounter an unconscious patient, what should be the management? So if you encounter an unconscious patient, whether in a hospital setup, forget about, or out of hospital setup, if you encounter an unconscious patient, first step is to assess scene safety. Scene safety means you have to see whether the scene is safe to do CPR. So that is safety for you and safety for the patient also. It's not that some building is collapsing and you start do CPR, then who will do your CPR? So you have to remove victim from collapsing building or airway or fires or any other, you can say, risk to you as well as patient. After assessing scene safety, now you have to assess responsiveness. And you assess responsiveness by shaking and shouting. Shake and shout. Are you okay? And this is important. It is not that you straight away go and start doing CPR. The person may be just simply sleeping. And many times in India, you see many people sleeping in parks or even roadside after just enjoying their evening. And they sleep wherever they become out. So it may be just simple sleeping. So just assess responsiveness before acting on. Okay. After assessing responsiveness, if you find the person to be unresponsive, then next step is call for help. If thereby nearby standers, you just call anyone, shout that this patient need help. So anyone who is walking around, moving around, will come. Then, but if nobody is there, then you should call EMS, emergency medical system, or emergency response team, or emergency services, whatever you call, through mobile app if available. India, it's not available. Mobile app, in your mobiles you will find app for everything, including pizza, burger, everything. Even undergarments app you may find. However, there is no app for life, unfortunately. But yes, most of the Western countries there is app. As soon as you press the app, automatically the rescue team will track you through GPRS and will reach you. So call for help and call emergency response team. If you find someone, then ask them to call for emergency response team. After calling for help or emergency response team, now you assess breathing and circulation. Breathing you just assess by scanning the chest movements. Look at the chest, whether the chest is moving or not, that's enough. And circulation, obviously, by palpating the carotids. However, 2020 guideline says if you are not able to palpate carotid pulse, you are not an expert. For a common man, I'm talking, not for medical people. For us, obviously, we should be able to palpate carotids, assess breathing properly. But for a common man, layman, if they're not able to assess properly, consider it absent. And even for us, if you are in doubt, consider it as absent. Okay, don't waste time. You should not take more than 10 seconds. Okay, after assessing breathing circulation, if you find, now there will be three situations. Breathing and circulation means carotid present. If they are present, you just need not do anything, just wait for emergency response team to arrive. That's it. Means patient doesn't require CPR, but he require hospitalization. So just wait for the emergency response team to come and then hand over patient to them. Second thing is breathing absent, but pulse present. this is rare. In pediatric, it can happen, but in adults, this is almost non-existent. Most often, breathing and pulse go simultaneously, but yes, rare circumstances if breathing is absent, but still you can palpate the pulse, then you have to give only breath at a rate of 10 to 12 breaths per minute. 10 to 12 breaths per minute through Embu bag, if that is available. Mouth to mouth, you can also give, but only if you are a trained rescuer. For us, obviously, being medical person, we are considered trained rescuers. So we will be giving breath mouth to mouth, 10 to 12. And obviously, in a hospital setup, you will have Embu. So bag and mask ventilation will perform. But outside hospital, you can give mouth to mouth. But for common men, mouth to mouth is not recommended. Third situation, which is most common, that is both breathing and pulse absent. If that is a scenario, then obviously immediately start CPR, starting with 30 compressions, 30 compressions over a period of 20 seconds, followed by 2 rescue breaths, and continue CPR till emergency response team arrives. And once the emergency response team arrives, then defibrillate if the rhythm is shockable as soon as possible. Correct. Now we can go to the choices and let's see. Now we can see the question. So the patient is unconscious while jogging in the morning. What would you check? Carotid pulse, CPR, call for help, shock if available. Call for help, check pulse, do CPR, observe, start CPR immediately. So, patient is in the park, so obviously no building is collapsing, there is no fire, so scene is already safe. Patient unconscious means no need to assess consciousness, already the situation is patient is unconscious, so obviously you will assess responsiveness. After assessing responsiveness, now you call for help. So, call for help, this one. After calling for help, yes, then you will be checking pulse and breathing simultaneously. If they are absent, start doing CPR. So I think this is the best choice, B. Okay, let me check whether recording is going properly or not. That's minus one fell. Because sometimes you keep on recording and later realize that nothing was recorded. Okay. Question number 4. Identify the equipment. Simple nasal cannula, non-invasive ventilation NIV, HFNC high flow nasal cannula, oxygen concentrator. Very much again expected question on high flow nasal cannula. I think diagram is not that clear. However, in exam it definitely would have been much clearer. these photographs are memory based, so little maybe piracy based. So this is high flow nasal cannula. See, high flow is coming and then there's humidifier. So, and then you give humidified gases to the patient. So this is a humidifier, you can see, and this is for high flow of oxygen, and this is a nasal cannula. Nasal cannula. So this was obviously, I told you, was very much expected question, high flow nasal cannula. So this high flow nasal cannula actually delivers very high flow. High flow means 60 to 70 liters. Very high flow. So what is the actually rationale of using this high flow? So this high flow, if you are delivering 60 to 70 liters per minute, means you are creating some kind of positive pressure. And one, you can say 10 liters generate a PEEP, that is positive and expiratory pressure of around, you can say, 1 centimeter of water. So 6 to 70 means you can say you are around 5 to 6 mm Hg, or 6 to 7 centimeter of water means it will be around 4 to 5 mm Hg of PEEP you can generate. So advantages with this high flow, you can generate some peep of around 4 to 6 mmHg, or you can say 6 to 7 centimeter of water. 1 mmHg is equal to 1.3 centimeter of water. And peep, you know, positive end expiratory pressure means it will not prevent alveolar collapse, so gas exchange will take place during expiration. Secondly, these gases are given humidified. Humidifier is there, so humidified gases are delivered, so chances of ciliary collapse, atelectasis, that is not there, generate humidified gases. Then it decreases anatomical dead space. How? When you are giving such high flow, obviously all conducting airways will be filled with oxygen. So that means you have removed carbon dioxide. So by removing carbon dioxide, indirectly you have decreased the anatomical dead space. Now, as far as if we say indications, so indications, actually this is initially when it was launched, and it was actually launched few years back, but couldn't become popular. But they become popular because of COVID. Because in COVID, initially, you know, we were not in the favor of non-invasive ventilation. So they devised some alternative, and that alternative was high flow nasal cannula. Because now I'm comparing it to NIV, non-invasive ventilation, you know, where we put a tight seal mask over the patient mouth and nostril, and positive pressure is given through ventilator. So NIV patient become very claustrophobic. So patients were not tolerating NIV. If high pressure is coming and it is very tight face mask, so patients become very claustrophobic and uncomfortable. High flow nasal cannula patients were very nicely tolerating. So I will say, if you ask me, that was the most important reason for high flow nasal cannula, or advantage of high flow nasal cannula over NIV, patient comfort level. Otherwise, definitely you can generate very good PEEP with the, as much as PEEP you want with NIV, and you can give humidified oxygen also through that by adding a humidifier, and obviously dead space can be increased or decreased depending on the flow. You can set flow rate. So there are actually advantages with NIV also. Most important thing, that these were very comfortable. So obviously, but if you ask me, even my experience of last 6-7 months by using NIV as well as high flow nasal cannula, actually they are not, as you, if you ask me effectiveness, definitely they are not as effective as NIV in maintaining oxygenation. Initially, when people started using, they were considering. But so indication I'll tell you later. So disadvantage I'll say, compared to NIV, I'm comparing with NIV. So don't get confused. I'm comparing only with NIV, not with the normal oxygen therapy like normal nasal cannula or oxygen mask. So with NIV, they are comparatively much less effective in oxygen, providing oxygenation. Yes, definitely they are far, far better than simple oxygen therapy by simple nasal cannula or simple oxygen mask. So they actually became, if you ask me indication wise, they actually are mid path between simple oxygen therapy, or you can say simple oxygen delivery devices. Then I'll put high flow nasal cannula. And then is the NIV, and obviously last is the intubation. Actually, there was a question I think last year in AIMS also, which created enough confusion also, in fact, that whether it decreases, other options were there, all are the advantages of, all of you must have seen that questions circulated a lot of times. I also received that question number of times, that what are the advantages of high flow nasal cannula. So providing humidified gases, decrease in anatomical dead space, generating PEEP. So all were advantages. The choice was whether it decreases the need of intubation. If you compare to NIV, so I will say that question is little incomplete. So compared to NIV, no. It does not decreases the need for intubation. In fact, if you ask me, I'll say it increases. With NIV, you can save more intubations as compared to high flow nasal cannula, in fact. But yes, compared to simple oxygen therapy, we will say that yes, it decreases the need for intubation. But if not mentioned, then we actually are comparing high flow nasal cannula with non-invasive ventilation, NIV, not with the simple oxygen delivery devices. So in nutshell, if not mentioned like in that question, so I'll say yes, it does not decrease the need for intubation. Okay. So obviously this is high flow nasal cannula. And again, a very much expected question. Question number 5. What is the size of this IV cannula? This is pink, 16, 18, 20. That all you know. I think number of times they are asking now. So we'll go from higher gauge to lower gauge. In terms of delivery of the flow, number, you know, with hypodermic needle or cannula, if the number increases, gauge size keep on decreasing. So 14 gauge is orange, 16 is gray, so then 17 white, 18 green, 20 pink, 22 blue, 24 yellow, and 26 is purple. So from here, these are pediatric cannula sizes. I told you, larger will be the number, smaller will be the gauge. So this is pink. Pink means 20. See. And important nowadays, I think last 3-4 consecutive exams, I am seeing they are asking the size of IV cannula. And that's very basic, actually, you should know. What is the correct concentration of adrenaline given through these routes? Okay. So first, adrenaline can be given through IV, intraosseous, endotracheal. These are the three routes which we utilize for giving adrenaline. In CPR, this is the preference also, IV, intraosseous, and endotracheal. And so this is during CPR. So these three routes we utilize during CPR. So concentration of adrenaline through all these three routes is 1 in 10,000. Only pediatric endotracheal concentration is 1 in 1,000. That is undiluted. The ampoule of adrenaline available is 1 in 1,000. However, for CPR, pre-mixed 1 in 10,000 syringes are available. So this is for CPR. Second use of adrenaline is for anaphylaxis. Anaphylaxis, almost we give IM. However, sometimes we can give subcutaneous also. If we are giving IM or subcutaneous, then we have to give on non-diluted, means concentrated, normal, that is 1 in 1000. Another use of adrenaline is along with the local anesthetic. With the local anesthetics, with lignocaine, the concentration available is 1 in 2 lakhs only. Although some books you see it is given 1 in 1 lakh, but that's not true. Only 1 in 2 lakh concentration is commercially available. Now we can see current sequence of adrenaline given through these routes. IM 1 in 10,000 wrong. IM is 1 in 1,000. IV 1 in 1 lakh. No, that's also wrong. IV is 1 in 10,000, not 1 in 1 lakh. Subcutaneous 1 in 1000. Yes, that is correct. Subcutaneous IM 1 in 1000. Abdominal 1 in 1 lakh. No, it is 1 in 2 lakhs. So the correct concentration is C, subcutaneous 1 in 1000. Identify the position. Oh, that is very simple. Trendelenburg, reverse Trendelenburg, lithotomy, jackknife, lateral decubitus. So obviously Trendelenburg is head low, so reverse Trendelenburg is head up. From anesthesia point of view, is if you ask me, the biggest complication of this problem is decrease cardiac output, high potential. Why? Head up position will decrease the venous return. So decrease venous return leading to decrease cardiac output and high potential. So that's the most major problem of reverse Trendelenburg. And this reverse Trendelenburg is most often applied in laparoscopic surgeries. Laparoscopic surgeries, they are mostly asking us to apply this reverse Trendelenburg. So laparoscopy itself increases the risk of hypotension by increasing intra-abdominal pressure and compressing the inferior vena cava. And reverse Trendelenburg further increases this hypotension by decreasing the cardiac output. So during reverse Trendelenburg for laparoscopic surgeries, we have to be very cautious about the blood pressure. Question number 8. Blue pipeline in OT is for which of the anesthetic gases? Again, very simple. Oxygen, nitric oxide, air, vacuum. So, four, you can say, pipelines you will see in operation theater. White pipeline is for oxygen. Blue pipeline is for nitrous oxide. Black is for air. And yellow is for central suction or central vacuum, you can say. So they ask blue. Blue is for nitrous oxide. So blue is for nitrous oxide, B. And air blue, and only yellow they have given in the diagram. Otherwise it should be 4. All panels are there. And through central supply, oxygen, nitrous oxide and air, they are supplied at a pressure of 60 pounds per square inch. In books, you will find answer given either 50 psi or 55 psi, depending from which book they have picked. Because in US, it is supplied at 50 and UK 55. But in India, majority of the centers, the central supply is at a pressure of 60 psi. So that's it. Very simple questions of anesthesia. Hope all you would have done very well. And my best wishes. Any doubt, any time, you can always contact our medical Facebook and on eGurukul, and we are ready to answer all of your queries. Again, my best wishes. Thank you very much.